For this problem, we're back to playing with spaceships. Actually, we're dealing with the Apollo 13 mission, which took off in 1970. It was supposed to take astronauts from the Earth and land them on the moon. However, at some point during their trip, they encountered a problem with one of their oxygen tanks, and they had to abort their mission of landing on the moon and instead figure out how to get the crew back to the Earth safely. Now, in this problem, we're going to show how changing the velocity of the ship using boost rockets can change the trajectory of the ship to make it loop around the moon instead of landing on the moon and bring it back to where it started on the Earth. Now, this is definitely the most complex problem that we've given you so far, so don't worry if it seems a little bit complicated at first. I'm going to help you out by breaking it into chunks and giving you some hints. Now, as always, we've told you some important information to start out with. We have some information about the Earth and gravity, and also some information about the moon, including the period of the moon, or the time that it takes the moon to orbit around the Earth. Now, one sort of unique value that you see here is moon initial angle, and this is just the angle at which the moon is initially placed from the Earth. If this is the 0 degree, or 0 radian line, then the angle between this line and the position vector of the moon is equal to moon initial angle. We also have the total duration of the flight that we're considering, and the tolerance measured in meters, which is related to the local truncation error that we're going to allow the flight path to have. Now, Jorn mentioned this briefly in the unit, and I'll give a little bit more explanation about it in a minute. We've laid out 5 tasks for you to complete to make the program run as a cohesive whole. The first one, which you can see right here, is to find the moon's position vector as a function of time. Now here we're going to consider the Earth as the origin here, so the position vector of the moon is just the vector from the Earth to the moon. Now remember, this is dependent on time. You can also assume that the moon is going to be moving counterclockwise around the Earth. Or at least that's how it looks in this picture. Now the next thing that you need to figure out is how to calculate the spaceship's acceleration due to gravity. Now the input here is time and position, but position right here is not the same as position that you just computed in the task above. Instead, this position is the position of the spacecraft, not of the moon. So in the second task, you're going to need to find the position of the spaceship depending on time, and then you'll need to figure out how the gravitational attraction to the Earth and to the moon affect its acceleration. Now think about how you can use vectors to do this. And also, as I said earlier, pretend that the Earth is at the origin. Now in each of the first 2 tasks, notice what your return values are, and make sure that you define variables with these names in their proper places in each function. So now we come to the slightly trickier part. In order to adjust the spaceship's trajectory to make it go around the moon, and then land back in the right spot on the Earth, it'd be really helpful if the crew had some control over its velocity during the flight. Lucky for them, and lucky for us too, their spaceship has rocket mechanisms that will allow it to reduce its speed on the way to the moon and increase its speed on the way back to the Earth. Now in the apply boost function right here, we've created 2 Boolean variables for you. And they're going to help your program simulate these changes in velocity. This first one refers to mid-course correction, or MCC. And this tells us whether or not the initial deceleration has occurred. Right now it's set to false, since at the beginning of the flight, this hasn't happened yet. Similarly, we have a second variable which refers to the descent propulsion system, or DPS, and this represents the second change in velocity. Now, the amount by which you are going to change the velocity at this point is what we're going to call the variable boost. Now, at these 2 moments, remember that we want to change just the magnitude of the velocity. We don't want to mess with the direction at all. That will deal with itself. So your third task is going to be to include these 2 velocity shifts, and of course, include them at the right times, which are listed in the code. You can notice that we've set up position and velocity vectors for you right here, and plugged in initial values as well. However, it's up to you to figure out how to adjust their values with each step using Hoyne's method and adaptive step size. You're going to do that down here in this while loop. Now here's Hoyne's method written out for you, just to help you out a little bit. Now once you've calculated position and velocity using Hoyne's method, you'll also need to adjust the step size at the end of the while loop to reset it with a new value for the next time that we go through the loop. Now, just as we did in section 12 of the unit, we're going to store whatever the present step size is as h, and whatever the step size that will be in the next step as h nu. To figure out the relationship between h and h nu, we need to calculate the local truncation error, or LTE. Now, the LTE is basically the error that is made in a single time step, or the difference after each time step between the exact quantity and the quantity estimated by the approximation method that we're using. So the new step size, h nu, is going to depend on the current step size, the tolerance, which we gave you earlier, and the LTE. So we can see that calculating the local truncation error takes into account the difference between the values of position calculated by Euler and by Hoyne, and the difference in values of velocity. T right here is the total duration of the flight so far. This needs to be here so that all of our units line up and LTE can be measured in length. Now once we've filled everything in, we're going to go back to the top of the apply boost function and figure out what the proper value of the constant boost is. Remember that our goal is to get the spaceship all the way around the moon and then have it just touch the surface of the Earth when it comes back. Now once you've filled in everything down here, go back to the top of the apply boost function and figure out what the proper value for the constant boost is. We've given you just an initial value of 0, but we've also given you some other values to try out. So try plugging each of these in and see what happens. Remember that our goal is to get the spaceship all the way around the moon and then come back to the Earth and just touch the place where it initially took off. Now because of the total time that we set at the top of our code, the ship's trajectory is not actually going to stop in your plot right when the ship gets back to the Earth. Instead, it's going to continue out from there as if the ship was going to go back to the moon a second time. Now, the reason we did this was to try to make it a little bit easier for you to tell which value of the boost you should use. The correct value of boost will have the tail of its trajectory reaching just back to the radius of the moon's orbit. Incorrect values of boost could make the trajectory end short, go off in the wrong direction, or even make the spaceship crash into the Earth, which we definitely don't want to have happen, and I'm sure the crew doesn't either. Now I know that this is a complex problem, but I'm sure that you'll be able to return the crew safely home. If you need any help, just come to the forums.